All right. Welcome. I'm Jill Menz, news editor at PhocusWire, and I'm joined here today with our next guest. We have Lola Akinmade Akerstrom, who is co-founder at Local Purse, and we're here today to talk about the live shopping experience in travel. So Lola, thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Great. So as we get started, let's define first, you know, what is live video shopping and what is it that Local Purse does that facilitates this experience?
Correct. So live video shopping is what they call live commerce, where when you want to buy something, you're actually interacting with a host, with a guide, with somebody that's selling you something. And then you can actually, during that session, buy the items as well. And this is a trend that's huge in Asia. That's kind of the future of retail, and it's slowly making its way westwards. And in terms of what we do within travel, we are taking this trend to help support local artisans and people that have been affected by the pandemic who can't really sell their goods to be able to sell it through this kind of live video shopping experience.
Yeah, so let's talk a little bit more about how the pandemic sort of inspired this idea. And how did you come about identifying the need for this in the market? You know, we've seen, you know, for example, tours and activities going virtual, but this definitely takes it to sort of a next level. So how did you sort of come up with this idea, you know, amid the chaos of the pandemic?
No, absolutely. So this was, I think, in September. I was part of a program where it brought together some founders to try and address some of the issues that the pandemic had caused. And I was thinking, first of all, the guides, right? Because when the pandemic hit, everybody was talking about airlines, hotels, restaurants, what they lost. But the people on the ground, people that, you know, local vendors, those are the ones that really kind of impacted a lot, you know, nothing to really fall back on. And so I started doing some research because I did see many companies pivoting straight away to virtual experiences, but then I started doing research on when we used to travel, right? What did we do when we traveled? And a lot of the statistics were showing me shopping tourism, where people were actually spent 50% in country. Most of the activities were shopping related activities. So even though maybe me and you are not the target audience, maybe that's not what we did, but most of the travelers that traveled did. And so that was where we started thinking about, okay, how can we combine that stat, you know, with helping the people that have lost the income and kind of see what's going on in the retail industry and bring it in.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, but something we've also seen with tours and guides and artisans, all that, is a lot of them, especially, you know, really small ones, they operate offline and, you know, not always the easiest to bring them online. How are you finding the guides that are participating, and how are you sort of bringing them on board and getting them into this sort of very new world, I'd argue? So,
right. And that is a very challenging thing, right? Because it also requires education, letting people know that this is a new way of potentially getting income. And remember, these are vendors that don't have e-commerce sites that usually operate in cash. And so with our platform, we can actually create their products on the fly for them. You know, as you know, the guide goes around and you point, we create that product and then we already have it in the system. And then in terms of vetting, you know, how do we vet? Mm-hmm. That's where our partner acquisition kind of strategy comes into place. We go with partners that we know are well vetted, that maybe have offline shopping experiences because they've already kind of vetted that supply chain. So that is kind of how we are going into the market in terms of looking at the right partners that maybe have similar offline products and then slowly bringing them into a web kind of virtual environment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know one company you've partnered with is Intrepid Travel. Can you talk a little bit about that specific partnership as well as if you have other potential partnerships in the works?
Yes, absolutely. So with Intrepid was the first kind of partner I went to right away because one, they're the largest B Corp travel company. So I know they're ethical, sustainable, the whole kind of supply chain is vetted. And also they have offline shopping experiences. And so they're already kind of used to kind of customers shopping, you know, because they have these products. And so it was a logical fit to go to them to kind of propose this idea as our first partner. And then we're also right now in the process of vetting and onboarding other partners in different destinations. The reason it's taking a bit of time is because it's not just a virtual experience, right? We actually have to make sure that the logistics, they can handle it, make sure that what the customer sees, they can get it to the destination and to the customer. So we do have a lot of partners in kind of onboarding them. But before we announce them, we want to make sure they're 100% ready because it's also new for them as well.
Mm-hmm. Right. Can you give some examples of an experience? You know, if I'm a consumer and I want to go experience something, what does that look like for me? What is my experience as a consumer? How do I do it?
Correct. So right now we have kind of two ways of bringing people on board. And so what we do is we call it the one-to-one experience, where you, if you're interested in, say, the Costa Rican, you know, coffee experience, you could book a one-to-one, which means you pay for the experience, the guide, you meet, the guide tells you about the culture, takes you around, and then you meet some local artisans. And then if you see products you like, you can actually point and say, this is what I want. The guide takes the picture, and through our system, it comes to on your own end as a product, and then you add it to your cart. Mm-hmm. So that's the dynamic part. And then sometimes we run events to kind of introduce people to a new destination, a new experience, to see if that's what they want. And that's where it's more of like a group live stream, mm-hmm. where maybe we have a special host, or I'm the host, and then I talk with the guide, and then you're part of the experience. So there are many, those are the two kind of ways we engage people with this kind of live video shopping experience.
Yeah, that's very cool that you it feels like you're actually shopping if there are different vendors that you can choose from. You're not just, you know, looking at one specific thing and shopping at one thing. What are some of the destinations these experiences are offered in?
Correct. So right now we have Morocco and we have Costa Rica, and we're going to add some additional experiences in Costa Rica. We're onboarding Argentina and Lagos, Nigeria, and some other interesting ones. So we have them in the pipeline. It just takes time to get them out because we're just a really small startup.
Yeah. So can you talk a little bit more about your customer acquisition strategy? And then, you know, with that, what are the challenges to scaling your service, you know, both for reaching new consumers, new markets, and, you know, operationally for your team?
Absolutely. So right now, our customer acquisition strategy has been kind of really slow. I mean, we're still bootstrapping. So that is kind of where we are, even though we've already gone with a live MVP that's working and generating some revenue. So our customer acquisition strategy is, we're now looking now into, like Makoto said, you know, more social campaigns, you know, influencer marketing. But the first stage where we went was, first of all, through our networks, through contacts, to kind of get a pulse to see what people wanted, if this was what they want, and to kind of review mm-hmm. kind of the you know, the return on investment. And now we've started identifying the right kind of focus group we're going to go for in our second stage of the customer acquisition strategy. And then the challenges, again, is, as with anything that's new, there's always resistance to change, right? Even though it is the future of retail, it is the future of travel in that space, people are always kind of reluctant. They're just kind of waiting for travel to just open up and start traveling, forgetting that we actually have to build back better and start building back in ways that are more sustainable as well, you know, for the future.
Absolutely. And you do mention that you're starting to get involved in influencer campaigns, that type of thing. Can you talk a bit about that and what platforms you're utilizing and what sort of makes the most sense for this product? Where are you going to get that engagement from?
Correct. So right now, we're actually that's going to be the next stage, because we're right now in our little, you know, we say stage one. So stage two now, we've started identifying the right customers based on the ones that have repeated the experiences with us. So we now know most of them are usually on Facebook, you know, based on kind of the demographics that we're looking at. So that's probably where we're going to now kind of aggressively try to find, and then Instagram as well. And so that is in terms of that customer acquisition strategy. That's kind of the first platforms we're going to start looking into.
Great. And for those that are experiencing Local Purse, are you seeing them post about the experience, you know, on their own? Are they taking it away and in engaging others with what they've done? How have you seen people sort of spread the word about what they've experienced?
Absolutely. And I think that's what's fascinating, right? Because when you think about it, live video shopping, people are not sure until they experience it, and then they love it, and then they share about it. So we've been getting a lot of word of mouth and people really supporting. So the people that join the experiences, then they share about it. Then mm-hmm. they, you know, they leave a review or they recommend it once they've experienced it. And not only that, a lot of them actually make purchases during the experience. So even if we have a small group, half of the group buys something and supports the artisans because they see where their money is going to directly. Yeah. So that's the thing. It's well tested. We know this works. You know, it's just kind of well market validated. So now it's the next stage for us is now to start kind of solidifying, you know, the business, then getting the funding we need to move faster because we're still bootstrapping.
Right. So that leads me to, you know, how does this concept evolve? I mean, you mentioned yourself earlier, some people are just holding back, waiting to get on that airplane, waiting to go on that tour in person. You know, as they start to do that more and more, where does Local Purse go from there? How do you fit into that ecosystem?
Absolutely. In fact, what we're trying to do is make travel more accessible, right? So even if people start traveling again, there are places they still can't go. Borders are not just open to everyone. And so what we've also noticed is people that sign up and join like the events, it's almost like a preview of a destination they would like to go to. Mm-hmm. It gives them a glimpse as well. And then for, cutting carbon footprints. So even though people are going to start traveling again, it's not like we're all going to be traveling every month. You know, a lot of Americans still have only their 2 weeks of vacation, right? But with this kind of experience, it actually opens up the world more to people. And that's what we're trying to do, onboard really interesting destinations, maybe places that they might not have considered in the past. And then, you know, as small as we are, we're super ambitious. We're actually fulfilling 6 of the UN sustainability goals. Wow. You know, yeah. So this is going to be kind of like a little backbone for the travel industry that doesn't require actual travel, so that when things happen, people aren't down to zero. There's actually still income. There's still a way to interact and still stay afloat in some ways. So when people start traveling, it's actually just going to give us breathing room to actually keep, you know, growing and doing it and solidifying the business.
That's fair. Yeah, I did want to touch on a little the sustainability aspect of it. I mean, you mentioned the United Nations sustainability goals. Can you elaborate a little bit, maybe for those in the audience who aren't quite familiar with what those are? And then, you know, how else is this sustainable form of traveler, you know, lowering a traveler's carbon footprint, for example, that type of thing?
Correct. So absolutely. And so the sustainability goals is to kind of create a future that we can, for the lack of a better word, sustain, right? One that's more equitable, that empowers communities, that makes communities more sustainable, that there's gender equality as well, innovation. So those are some of the, you know, the goals that we're fulfilling. So in terms of equity, right, because now we're creating something that's a lot more accessible, because travel, as much as we love travel, it's still a privileged kind of experience. You know, you only have money, funds to be able to travel. So if you start opening the world in ways that are a bit more equitable, then it makes it more accessible for other people. In terms of gender equality, we're already starting with our own team, which is, you know, mostly women on our team. And it's not that we just seek that, but that's what we're also trying to empower and make sure that, you know, women are making decisions as well in this, in our business. And then just in terms of innovation, this is something new, trying to innovate the travel industry by using existing technology, existing, you know, innovations in other industries that work well. And we know it's a macro trend, like we said, in other industries. So we're just trying to bring portions of it into the travel industry where it makes sense.
Right. Yeah. Can you give some examples where you've seen this be successful outside of travel? I know you mentioned earlier that this is really caught on in Asia. What have you seen elsewhere that you think really is applicable to travel in that sense?
Absolutely. So the live video shopping is huge in Asia. So when you think about Alibaba and all like the big kind of retail e-commerce sites, they all have, you know, live video streaming channels. even in the US many years ago, you know, when you think of QVC and Home Shopping Network, those are like the forebearers of this kind of live video shopping kind of experience, but within retail, within kind of lifestyle goods. And kind of the big player trying to move into the travel space with live video shopping is Amazon, which also lets us know it's a market validated idea, right? Because they're also trying to come in with Amazon Explore and do the live video shopping. So that is kind of where, you know, we've seen this. It's mostly in retail and fashion, but just very few, not many players are bringing it into travel. And the only other player doing it within travel is Amazon, you know, with Amazon Explore. So we've got the Goliath and David thing going. But we know it's a market validated idea. So,
yeah. Do you see more travel brands, especially, you know, bigger players that have the resources to invest in this stuff? Do you see them exploring this more? How do you sort of see the outlook for this in the next, say, 5 years? Like, where do you sort of see travel with live shopping within 5 years?
Correct. So, I mean, I do hope people open up to it, because the first thing we always say is, well, I don't like shopping, right? Most travelers are like, well, I just like to explore and this. But think about, maybe you are not the target audience for kind of this. And then a lot of companies don't really want to deal with the logistics, which is what we are getting into, and figuring out the right logistics partners and figuring out the pain points. And because we're small and starting from the bottom up, we can actually know a lot more of the pain points for the artisans, those on the ground, than if we were a real big company coming from the top down, trying to just create, you know, create a business model for this. So that is kind of where we are. A lot of people don't want to, it's a painful space that people don't want to get into, but we know that if we can help and figure out a lot of that pain, it's going to really boost and help the industry. So that's why we're there.
Yeah, that makes total sense. You're really building it with them, as opposed to your infrastructure's in place, bringing them into something
exactly.
That's already.
Exactly.
What would you say has been, you know, throughout this experience, what has your biggest learning been about, you know, trying to put this live shopping experience together?
I think the biggest experience, I mean, first of all, you know, like we said, you know, we're still doing it with no active funding. And that's because we haven't spent a lot of time raising funds. We actually spent on more customer acquisition and partner acquisition and trying to educate. But I'll say the biggest learning experience is being able to look at other industries and see what they're doing that can be brought in. Mm-hmm. Because with the travel industry, yes, we lost a lot, but look at the future of work and remote meetings and conferences. The travel industry should spend a lot more money on just remote kind of summits, you know, trade shows. That will save a lot of money that can go directly to other things, as opposed to all meeting physically. So I think the travel industry is one of the last to innovate. As much as we think we're the most, you know, advanced industry, we are one of the last. And we need to look at other industries and see where we can innovate and move things to a more digital environment. So,
absolutely. All right, we're coming up on time, but I want to ask one more question, and just, you know, how else do you see local purse evolving? And I know we talked about if other players could get in the space, but do you also potentially see an opportunity for local purse to integrate with other apps or platforms, or bring it to new places?
No, absolutely. And for us, it's too early to tell, right?
Right.
I mean, the fact that we're already creating this means we're already open to new ideas, being open to ideas, even if they're disruptive, but that's going to create change. And our soul is really about social impact. So anything we can do to really make sure that there's more equity being created and, you know, the people that are affected the most get help, that's kind of where we are. And so it's too early to tell who we're going to partner with or how we're going to pivot, but that, you know, we're open to it, because I mean, the fact that we already created this little disruptive startup,
yeah,
we're open to anything. So
great. All right. Well, Lola with Local Purse, thank you so much again for joining us here today on our third Pulse. So thanks again.
Thank you so much.